Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guests today are two professors from UCLA, Tom Bradbury and Benjamin Carney. They have written a book, well, it's Elvis Presley saying, Love Me Tender. But if he'd listened to these doctors, and he might still be here, he would have sang, Love Me Slender. How many couples are, really, how smart couples team up to lose weight, exercise more, and stay healthy together. It's published by Simon & Schuster. Welcome, Tom. Welcome, Ben.
Thanks for having us.
And interesting, Love Me Slender. This is about young couples getting married, and now suddenly who's cooking and who's eating.
Exactly.
And also, who's running after dinner.
Precisely.
Begin with how you started this subject.
Well, Tom and I have been doing research on couples for many years. And one of the things that we've studied for a couple decades is how couples communicate together about things they want to work on and change in their own lives.
Mm-hmm.
And we published on how to do that well, how to support each other well and poorly for years. But a few years back, we thought to say, well, what is it that couples are actually working on? Not just the process, but the content. What do couples want to accomplish? And when we went back and looked, we were surprised to find that nearly two-thirds of the time, what these young, healthy couples wanted to work on is diet and exercise. They were worried about their weight. They could see the problems coming in the future, and they wanted to make a difference.
And what's interesting, too, is that these couples may say they want to lose weight, but there's a lot of sabotage there.
That's right. So it is very common for people at all stages of their life to say, look, I want to be a little healthier. I want to be a little tighter. I'm not feeling as energized as I usually am. I need to do something about this. And I want my partner to join in with me. And naturally, we think the partner will say, great idea. How can I help you? What can I do that will really make sure that you reach your goals? But all too often, the partner says, hey, honey, but look at these great brownies. We can start the diet tomorrow. So you're absolutely right that lots of times our partners don't really hear us when we're saying, no, I'm serious. I really want to make this change, and I really want you to be part of it.
And also, the partner who says, oh, you've lost enough. Let's go out to dinner.
Exactly.
Yeah.
When one partner wants to make a change, sometimes it puts pressure on the other person.
Yeah.
And the other person may not be ready to make the same change.
As somebody once said, marriage is like a scale. And if one side changes, the other side is supposed to change your balance. Not always.
What's crazy is they don't always want to change, but they always do. Because there's no getting around what we call the interdependence of the two partners. Mm-hmm. If one person makes a change, it affects the other person, whether the other person wants to change or not.
Yeah. Let's start with some of the people you talk to in this book. And among them, it really comes down to eat right, move more. That's sort of like on their forehead. Eat right, move more. And the woman who says, look, let's go. I want to go out every morning and exercise. And he's sort of saying, yeah, but you're not going to do it if you say you're going to do it. And finally, he's the one who also says, I'm thinking of asking for a promotion. Do you think I should? Well, you know darn well she's going to say, oh, you'll never get it.
That's right. So one of the important things to realize in the couples that we've studied, we come in and we get a snapshot of their life, right? We get an hour to maybe 3 or 4 hours with them, videotaping them. And we study those conversations really intently. But we know there's a history to those conversations. And we know that the kind of relationship that you're suggesting here, that is a woman who's tried to change many times in the past. Her husband's heard it before, right? And so he's hearing the same thing that she said all along. And that's a difficult position for him to be in. And what we're hoping to do with our book, Love Me Slender, is to get him to a place where he says, oh, I get it. Change is a process. You know, being healthier brings frustration and failure with it. And that's what my partner is going through. I've heard that many times. I've heard her fail. My job as a supportive partner is to say, this time it's going to be different. Let's break through that. Help me out and help me to understand what's going to work for you now, because I want to provide that. It's important that I have a healthy partner. How can we do that? How can we create a relationship where that's most likely to happen? Let's forget about the past a little bit.
What is the standard of the young couples who come to you? At what point?
We've done research on a lot of different kinds of couples, but most of our research is focused on young couples who are just married for the first time. Mm-hmm. So, but then we follow them over time. So we've got studies where we look at the first 3 to 4 years of marriage, uh-huh. and studies where we look up to 10 years of marriage, and other studies where we're looking at couples who've been married for quite a long time. So uh-huh. we see couples at all different ranges.
Yeah. The ones who come to you right away, what do you see? How do they describe themselves as opposed to pre-marriage?
It's an interesting question. There aren't a lot of differences between pre-marriage and post-marriage, at least right around the wedding. Like before weddings, we haven't studied people who are engaged, but research on engaged couples says those couples are super happy, super optimistic, very excited. Right after the marriage, they're still pretty optimistic and pretty happy.
Uh-huh.
The question that we ask in a lot of our research is, then what? Over mm-hmm. the subsequent years, some of those happy couples stay happy and optimistic. Some of them become less optimistic, and some of them divorce.
When you are asking, do you have a list of questions before you start to take them on, such as, do you drink? Have you used drugs? Did you do it together?
In most of our studies, we recruit generally from the newlywed population. So they're not screened in any way. These are fairly typical couples, mm-hmm. people who might be a lot like your next door neighbors or your sons or daughters' kids. They're pretty typical folks. Like, if you were to see them, you'd say, yeah, ordinary folks, I get it.
Yeah.
And they're pretty healthy, most of mm-hmm. them. But what's interesting is that even though they're young and even though they're in love, when one of them says, I want to lose some weight, they still struggle. They still find ways to misunderstand each other. They miss opportunities where they could say, oh, let's try this together, or maybe we could do this. We're even though they're healthy, happy people, they're also at a stage of their life where lots of different things are going on. They're thinking about having children if they don't already have a young child in the house. They're often either finishing school or making the transition to a 9-to-5 job. So their relationships are becoming more stable, but also the number of demands and challenges that they have in their daily lives are also going up.
What age group are we talking about?
Again, across a lot of our studies, the age ranges pretty broadly, but in newlyweds tend to be in their late 20s to early 30s.
Mm-hmm. So it's a later era than used to be.
Certainly is.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. So in a way, they have settled down to their weight, and usually it's a little bit over.
Well, certainly as a nation, people are generally a little bit over where they should be for a healthy weight. What our research shows and some of our colleagues is that when people get married, they start eating more regularly, and most married couples gain weight in the first mm-hmm. years of marriage. And what our research shows is that the happiest couples gain the most weight.
Yeah. That's great, because she's cooking for him, he's buying for her.
That's one reason. Another one is that when you're young, people aren't worried about their health.
Yeah.
So for them, weight management is about being attractive. Well, you've got that locked down.
Yeah.
You're married to someone. So some of these people relax their physical appearance maintenance.
Yeah, they let themselves go a little bit.
We see
that all the time.
Well, you let couples sort of show you how they talk. Yeah. And some of the talk here, as I'm reading, I said, I don't think this marriage is going to last, because there's a lot of antagonism that seems to come out.
You would think that an issue as simple as, hey, let's be healthy together, would be an opportunity for people to say, honey, what a great idea. I'm so happy that you're raising this, because you like to be active, I like to. You would think it'd be the greatest conversation
no,
in the world.
No, you're criticizing
They're difficult conversations,
yes.
Right. Because you saying that you want to lose some weight, and I say, wait a minute, are you saying I should lose weight? Or, wait a minute, are you saying you want to look better for other people? Is that the message? And even if couples don't necessarily articulate everything that's going on below the surface like that, those emotions come out. And so when one person says, look, I'd like to lose some weight, the other person says, you look fine just the way you are.
Right? Yeah.
And that is not a positive thing to say in this specific context. So these are we were surprised to discover that these are emotionally laden issues. These are difficult issues. And if couples can get the upper hand on them, we really think they have an opportunity to team up with one another, keep each other's health habits in check, inspire each other so that they really can be healthy together.
Well, and also because it's part of you that says, that's what my mother used to say.
Oh, exactly.
Yeah. She was always saying, lose weight or you won't get a husband, or lose weight, you won't get promoted. It's weight becomes more than weight.
Well, exactly. And that's something that we were surprised to find. And that we saw the couples were surprised to find it too, is they started a conversation on weight because they thought, oh, that's easy. We'll talk about food. We'll talk about scheduling exercise. But we saw in tape after tape that suddenly this becomes a conversation about, am I attractive? Do you love me? What do you love about me? What are the limits of your love? Would you still love me if I gained weight? And suddenly a conversation that was supposed to be very light becomes really emotionally laden.
Yeah. Especially, I know of a couple where the husband, the wife was trying to lose weight, buys her a designer outfit, but he forgot that on the side of the trousers were buttons, big buttons. So instead of looking thinner, she looked that much bigger. And you say, wait a minute, was he trying to sabotage?
Mm-hmm. And maybe he was, or maybe, so sometimes the couples are trying to sabotage because they are threatened by the partner trying to change. Other times, partners really don't know. We see couples where you can see on the face of one spouse that that person wants to help, and they don't know how. And that's kind of why we wrote the book.
And here come some of the questions. Ask yourself, have you made any direct effort to affect your partner's behavior around diet and exercise? Has your partner made any direct efforts to affect your behavior? And how have they worked? And there's a whole group of questions that you guys have put into your book, which, you know, you almost need to get two copies of this book, one for him and one for her.
We encourage that.
Yes, I would believe that. How did you decide on the title?
We spent a lot of time thinking about the title. We wanted a pithy title that would really capture the intimacy part. Like, you and I are in a relationship, let's take advantage of that. And then the health benefits. And so we spent a lot of time pondering, wondering what the pithiest way to say that would be. But when we did finally land on this title, we recognized that this was really a very simple way of summarizing what the couples themselves had been saying all along in their in our tapes, which was, let's use our relationship to help me be a little healthier. Or how can we figure out a way to use the strengths that we know are in our relationship to take better care of ourselves, not just emotionally, but physically? How can we do that? So it took a lot of brainstorming to come up with the title. Mm-hmm. But once we landed on it, we really did come to appreciate that this is what couples were saying to one another, often in the first 30 seconds of our conversations.
One of the interesting couples was the one who is working hard. They both are. But she gets off a little earlier, and she says, I've got to be home for you. I've got to be cooking. I've got to be doing.
He's
saying, take it easy. Go to the gym. Take that hour for yourself. Let me come home. I'll get the food started. And it was almost like he was assuming her role in her head.
Well, I think what that couple understood is sometimes the best thing I can do for my partner is give my partner some space. Sometimes the most generous thing I can do for my partner is say, go do your own thing, especially around exercise. We see other couples get sort of trapped by this, is they say, well, we have to exercise together.
Yeah.
We can't ever exercise together because we're too busy, so we don't exercise.
Yeah.
And this the couple that you're referring to understood that, hey, your health is very important. Here's what I'll do. I'll take care of the business so that you can get the exercise that you need, and then maybe we'll trade off and you'll do the same for me. I think that they really figured something out there.
Yeah, but it was interesting to hear what each one of them said at that point.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's true. Is that they weren't being trapped by gender roles.
Yeah.
They were saying, look, I'll do what needs to be done. It doesn't matter whether it's supposed to be done by you or by me. I'll just do what needs to be done.
Yeah. The other was the one who says, I want to watch TV. Couch potato, but that's my pleasure at this moment. I'm tired.
That's right. That was in the very first chapter of the book. And that was a very important couple for us to watch. We saw that tape, that's Sarah and Brian, and we could see that they were very much in love, like almost all of our couples are. They're newlyweds. She really wanted to lose 10, maybe 15 pounds. Mm-hmm. She was really upfront about that. And he was equally upfront about saying, you know, that's you, that's not me, right? I don't need to do that for myself. And it was hard for him to appreciate how even the smallest gestures could have really unleashed her ability to be active and really healthier. And we, in a way, we think a lot about that couple when we were writing the book, because that was that moment where we said, two people love each other, they communicate fine, they both sort of want the same thing, they both want to be healthy, and he couldn't see that just by saying, oh honey, you know, how about if we get an exercise bike? Maybe that'd be a good thing for you to do. Or how about if we really time it just right so I'm not watching TV? Or if you ask me in just this way, then I'll join with you and we can do that together. So what we believe is that most couples don't need a big shift in their communication style, but if they learn just a few tips, they can say, oh, we can both be healthy together. We really can be a stronger team. I'll get up off the couch, it'll be good for me, it'll be good for you as well, and we're both moving in the right
direction.
And
what about the one who says, wait a minute, we got that treadmill, it's a statue now. I mean, that's one of the things, whether it's your young couples or not, they say all of these equipment, they become, you know, statues in the family.
We saw that so many times in our tapes, that it's easy to get started, it's hard to keep it going. And one of the things we talk about in the book is, one of the reasons it's hard to keep it going is that in the short term, we see, there's so many things I'd rather do than walk on that treadmill.
Yeah.
In the long term, of course, I want to be healthy. But it's hard to keep your eye on the long term when, on the short term, the couch is so comfortable. Mm-hmm. What we talk about in the book is that we're not naturally wired to think in the long term, except in our relationships. In our relationships, we naturally say, oh, I want to grow old with you. I want to see our grandchildren with you. So partners can use that to remind each other of their long-term goals. Wait a minute, you do want to be healthy in the long term. When those long-term goals are in mind, the old age, to be healthy together, to see grandchildren, that makes it, making the choice in the short term a lot easier.
Yeah.
The short to get on that treadmill, to get back on that treadmill, to make that healthy choice, have a few more vegetables.
Well, what about sex?
I'm in favor of it.
Yes, I'm glad. But how, you know, how does this affect, we're sitting, we're now married a year, it gets a little, you know, I know you. What are you gonna do?
That's a good question.
One of the most reliable phenomena in our fields is that once we've settled into a relationship, we get comfortable in a relationship, it loses some of its very special polish. We adapt, we get used to it. It's true of our cars, it's true of our washing machines, it's true of almost everything. It's part of our apparatus as human beings. We grow accustomed to things that we even value tremendously at the very start. On average, we know that that's true. What we love about the message in Love Me Slender, in what a lot of research shows, especially research by a colleague named Art Aaron at Stony Brook University, is that you can counteract that tendency. And the way you counteract it is you do new, novel, challenging, and arousing activities together. It can be sex, and I hope it is, but mm-hmm. it can also be a salsa lesson. It can also be hiking around. It can also be going to a new part of town and trying a new restaurant that you haven't tried out before. When we inject new life into our relationships, often through exercise, really getting our heart mm-hmm. pounding, we slow down the rate at which that gloss, we lose that gloss of our relationship. And one of the points that we really love about this book is that when we're taking care of our partner and when our partner is taking care of us, that allows us to be closer. Even though you're simply saying to me, honey, have these vegetables, they're so good. Try this instead of that cake. I love you, I wanna be with you for a long time. That message registers with us very deeply. And so by taking better care of ourselves and our partners and our relationship, our strong hunch is that our relationships grow stronger as well. And there's plenty of evidence from the medical literature showing that when people are healthier, when they are more active, when they're eating better, their sex lives really do improve.
Mm-hmm. There's not a little bit of get off my back? You know, stop telling me to lose weight and all of this.
Absolutely. We see this a lot in our tapes. One partner says, I need help, or I want to lose weight. And the other partner says, oh, in that case, what option do I have but to nag you?
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things we try to offer in the book is other options, is that you have choices. There's ways you can affect your partner, help your partner without nagging. Here's an example. If you do the shopping for your household, you can shop for healthier foods without nagging your partner. And suddenly your partner's living in a house with healthy foods in it.
Mm-hmm.
No nagging. Just when your partner goes to the fridge, there's a bunch of healthy foods in there.
Yeah.
Goes to the pantry, there's a bunch of healthy foods in the front and the unhealthy foods are in the back. There are small things. We talk about a lot of those examples in the book. Small things that we can do without nagging, without pressuring, that just makes it easier for our partners to be healthy.
Yeah.
Why wouldn't we do it?
So instead of, say, you go to Trader Joe's, you go to natural food, you could also go to 99-cent store and get the fresh fruit there.
Absolutely, absolutely. That's a gift we can give to our partners that doesn't require nagging, doesn't require convincing or haranguing them, and yet it works.
Okay, which of these marriages really lasted? Because do you follow up on them?
Yeah, we do.
Yeah.
We follow them, but not for their whole lives.
Yeah.
But we follow almost all those couples for between 3 and 10 years.
And what now becomes what you call the exerciser?
Say more about that. I'm not sure what you want to know.
Yeah. Who is an exerciser?
In our studies?
Yeah.
We find that people vary quite widely in how they think about managing their weight. Some people manage their weight really just by, without doing anything at all, right? We all know people who can manage their weight somehow magically and eat anything they want and not exercise.
Yes.
We know those people. I'm not one of those people. Other people really can manage their weight just by eating healthy. Other people really need to do everything in their power. They really need to monitor almost every mouthful, really stay active. And those issues naturally come into relationships, right? It's not as though, while it is the case that most of us benefit in the same way from the same foods, vegetables are really pretty good for all of us. Different people prefer different kinds of exercise, and they need to negotiate that. They need to find a way to have a conversation. And often what we see in discussions of diet and exercise is one person saying, this is what worked for me. Just try to do this, because this is what worked for me. And often that falls on deaf ears, because the other person says, first, I hate exercise, and second, I'm not going to go to the gym because I'm not comfortable in the gym. And what needs to happen in those kinds of conversations is not do X, do this because this worked for me, but a question, an opening. What do you think would work for you? What were some of the activities you really liked when you were in college, when you really were fit and taking good care of yourself? Those are the questions we want
couples
to ask.
Then I look at him or she looks at me and says, you're a taskmaster. What's a taskmaster?
Well, a taskmaster is the person who says, oh, I know what you need. You need some tough love. I'm going to whip you into shape. I'm going to take control. And this is a balance that we see a lot of couples struggling with. You need help? Do I back off and let you do what you need to do? Or do I step in and be a taskmaster and tell you what to do?
Yeah.
And there's a middle ground in there that you don't have to choose one or the other.
Mm-hmm.
There's ways that you can offer support without being a taskmaster, and there's ways that you can affect your partner without being a nagger. And yet, there's also a demand that you do get involved. And
mm-hmm.
we say in the book, you're going to have to get involved in your partner's weight maintenance, whether you want to or not. You can't avoid it. If you share a kitchen, if you share a pantry, if you eat meals together, then you're involved.
And he also knows how to say, or you say to him, have you seen how Jim looks these days? Wow. And there's a look that comes and on the other side where he says, gee, Maureen looks marvelous.
Yeah.
Yeah, who wants to hear that somebody thinks other people look better?
That is another example of trying to influence your partner in maybe a way that might backfire. So what we're trying to fill this book with is giving couples tools for influencing your partner in a constructive way, in a way that A, is less likely to backfire and more likely to achieve results.
Now, what do you two do for exercise?
We're both pretty healthy. We actually talked a lot about our health long before we thought about writing a health book.
It's really true.
We've studied couples since the early 90s. We've studied thousands of couples. We like talking about our health. We like being active, and we exercise a lot. I think it's interesting to know what I do to trick my wife into being healthy. And this relates to your earlier point, Connie, which is the treadmill gathers dust, right? The exercise machine gathering dust. We have a gym membership, and we only feel terrible about not using it, but we never use it.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that we've discovered from watching so many couples struggle with these issues, and what I do, is I try to find a way to combine something that my wife really likes to do with being on the treadmill. And more than that, I've tried to get her addicted to specific television shows. And we only watch TV when we're on the treadmill.
Mm-hmm.
My wife is now totally addicted to a television show. Fortunately, there are 180 episodes on Netflix. And 5 or 6, even 7 days a week, she's banging out 45, 50 minutes of an episode on the treadmill. And it's worth saying, what's the bigger principle? What's the idea?
Yeah.
And the idea is I can sort of see that it helps my wife relieve stress to be on a treadmill, and I see benefits even beyond the sort of the health management idea. But I can also know that she really can use that as her own downtime. And what the principle is, it allows me as her partner to say, she needs some downtime. She'll find that to be great. It's really important to her. But she's pairing something she really likes with something she doesn't like.
Yeah.
And you take the edge off the aversive experience with this amazing TV show, and you can't wait to watch the next episode, so you get on the treadmill.
I tell you, I'm going to that treadmill the minute I get home.
Very
good.
Will
you gentlemen autograph my book?
With pleasure.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. Support your local library. There are terrific books to read, but this book is for the young couple. Anyhow, support it, and we'll see you next time. Thank you.
Thank you, Connie.
Oh, pleasure.